And let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our Bureau Chief, TJ Manotok.
Good morning to our friends at The Rundown. I'm TJ Manotok here at the headlines in the North American region.
We begin with the representatives from each brand of the U.S. Armed Forces, the Philippine Consulate, law enforcement, veterans groups, and members of the community coming to the San Francisco National Cemetery to pay their respects for Filipino and American soldiers of World War II.
Filipinos and Americans fought side by side in the trenches of the Philippines during World War II. The relationship between the United States and the Philippines was forged in blood.
The celebration also featured the families of 8 Filipino World War II veterans receiving the Congressional Gold Medal, the nation's highest civilian award that was conferred on Filipino veterans in a public law signed by then U.S. President Barack Obama in 2016. April marked the 105th awarding ceremony in the U.S. and the 82nd anniversary of the Bataan Death March.
Today we are here to honor and remember the Americans and the Filipinos who were lost at Bataan. We salute those who survived captivity. We salute those resilient service members who built their own internal hope step by step, mile by mile, and day by day along the path of the 65 to 70 mile death march.
And finally, back in San Francisco, from meat patties on the grill to chicken thighs in the fryer, it's a busy opening day for the city's newest restaurant, Izzy and Wook's. Filipino-American couple Manuel and Cheryl Ramirez says the menu was created to offer a modern take on classic American burgers and sandwiches with a Filipino twist.
We're doing Asian fusion, spins primarily Filipino, Korean, Japanese influences on classic American sandwiches. So we do a smash burger, a Nashville hot chicken, a Chicago-style Italian beef, but with Filipino and Asian flavors.
Their Izzy Truck Smash Burger features house-ground short rib and beef chuck patty smash on the flat top with grilled banana ketchup onions. Their tamarind hot chicken sandwich features whole chicken thighs, brined in soy sauce, and calamansi, then twice fried in a mochiko batter and dipped in their tamarind hot oil, which they say was inspired by Filipino sinigang soup.
And those are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region. You can catch more of our TFC News on our website, news.abs-cbn.com/TFC News. Head on over to the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel and download the ABS-CBN News app for your smartphones and tablets. I'm TJ Manotok. Back to your friends at The Rundown.
Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu vows to fight sanctions that could be imposed on any of the country's military units. Axios News reported on Saturday Washington was planning to hold the Natsa Yehuda Battalion to account for alleged rights violations in the occupied West Bank. The Israeli military says it was not aware of any measures being taken.
I will fiercely defend the IDF, our army, and our fighters. If anyone thinks they can impose sanctions on the unit of the IDF, I will fight it with all my strength. As our soldiers are united to protect us on the battlefield, we are united to protect them on the political field. Together, we will fight, and with God's help, together we will win.
In an address to the nation ahead of the Jewish holiday of Passover, Netanyahu also pledged to secure the release of 133 hostages still being held by Hamas. Hamas leader Ismail Haniyeh blaming Israel for stalling a ceasefire. Haniyeh says despite extensive negotiations, all Israel wants is the release of hostages so they can continue the war and refuse to agree on a complete withdrawal from Gaza. Haniyeh spoke following a meeting with Turkish President Tayyip Erdogan, who says diplomatic efforts continue for a permanent ceasefire as well as an independent Palestinian state. Haniyeh's visit took place amid escalating regional tensions following Israel's reported attack on Iran last week, which he also blames on the Jewish state. The mayor of Tuguegarao decrying what she called the unfair scrutiny of Chinese students in Cagayan. Mayor Myla Tingke says fears that the students may be threats to national security are baseless. She insists Tuguegarao is home to universities recognized by the Commission on Higher Education as centers of excellence, making them attractive to foreign students. Data from the Bureau of Immigration earlier showed there are around 1,500 Chinese students in Cagayan.
Napaka-unfair sa mga eskwelahan who work so hard to achieve what credibility they have now. You're very, very disappointed but by what has come out. Kasi we've been fighting so hard to promote. Now it's being eroded. Now it's being questioned. Now there is a cloud hanging over us. That's painful and hurtful to us. We denounce what happened over at the West Philippine Sea. Pero let us also remain calm and be very careful of our pronouncements on social media.
Kea also slams Cagayan Representative Joseph Lara, who first flagged the increasing presence of Chinese students in the province, calling it suspicious and alarming. Lara has also filed a resolution seeking a House probe on the matter.
Wala man lang intergovernmental, intra or intergovernmental courtesy na ginawa itong congressman na ito. There was also a time back a few years ago before the pandemic, that puro Indians naman po yung naglalakad, no? Madami rin. Puro Koreans. So, it's not really something that is new to us.
Cagayan Province is home to two military sites that American troops can use under the Enhanced Defense Cooperation Agreement. The National Security Council has sent intelligence officials to Cagayan to monitor if there are national security threats in the area. Senate Minority Leader Coco Pimentel, meanwhile, calls on the Commission on Higher Education to investigate the alleged influx of Chinese students in Cagayan before the upper chamber makes a move. He says the facts should be established first, including the actual number of foreign students. Pimentel adds any cause for concern on the issue is not yet clear.
Kaya tayo na-focus dito sa issue kasi ginamit yung salitang marami. Kaya nga sabi ko sa ang aking opinion kasi yung salitang marami, subjective yun. Meron lang siguro akong word of caution. Mainit masyado ang local politics kasi sa probinsya ng Cagayan eh. O, kaya tingnan na rin natin kung yung gamit ng mga loaded na salita o subjective na salita, eh baka naman konektado ito sa local politics po dyan sa probinsya ng Cagayan. Ang aking position ay, imbestigahan na ito ng CHED. Tapos bigyan na lang kami ng numbers ng CHED. Pag ayaw, saka tayo kikilos pag hindi mag... Number one, pag hindi ito imbestigahan ng CHED at saka or hindi magbigay ng report sa amin ang CHED.
China flexing its military might ahead of the joint exercises between Manila and Washington. According to maritime security expert Ray Powell, two Chinese maritime militia ships and a Chinese Coast Guard vessel were seen loitering near Palawan Sunday. Powell says Beijing's action signals it is on high alert amid the military drills between Manila and its allies. This year's annual Balikatan, or shoulder-to-shoulder drills, will involve naval exercises outside Manila's territorial waters in areas close to Taiwan, which is also being claimed by Beijing. At least 16,000 troops from the U.S., the Philippines, and France will participate in the joint activities. It will run from April 22 to May 10.
I sense that this is probably some kind of a demonstration, again, a reminder to the Philippines that China will remain aggressive even though the Philippines is in the middle of its big exercise.
Maybe that China figures during Balikatan is the time to do this to make sure that the Philippines knows that once the Americans go home from their exercise, that China will very much still be here.
The Philippine Energy Department rules out sabotage in the recent power plant failures in the country. Luzon and Visayas were repeatedly placed under red and yellow alerts last week due to forced outages and weak capacity of power plants. But the DOE says the incidents were mainly due to the high electricity demand in the country amid the extreme heat.
Mataas lang po talaga yung demand natin kung kaya't nakaka-stress din po yung sa system natin or nakakapili po ba na mag-produce tayo ng lahat ng kaya ng mga planta kung kaya't sa sobrang init din, eh hindi natin inaasahan man ay meron po mga nagkakaroon talaga ng internal problems. Yun naman po mga pinakita sa atin na mga proofs nila ay sufficient po at makubisi tayo na talaga pong internal problem ang nangyari. Patuloy po yung pagre-repair nila para po makabalik na rin sila online at full capacity.
The agency also sees better power conditions this week thanks to the continuing restoration of power transmission services in some of the affected areas in the country. The family of one of the Filipino workers who died during the flooding in Dubai still coping, still coming to grips with her passing. Jenny Gamboa, along with fellow OFW Marjorie Saking, were said to be on their way home when their shuttle bus became stranded, leading to their suffocation inside the vehicle. Gamboa, who worked in Dubai for 19 years, was the sole breadwinner of the family.
Kasi sabi ko ganun, kung nasuffocate sila, pati yung dalawang lalaki, suffocated din. Kaya nag-iisip kami na parang may foul play na nangyari sa kanila.
Inaantay pa natin yung formal na findings din ng UAE authorities na explain na rin sa mga pamilya yung proseso ng pag-repatriate. May paperwork lang, ano? Yung mga documents, mga forensic reports, police report, and of course, yung assurance na pati funeral and burial expenses, sasagutin natin.
The Department of Migrant Workers, meanwhile, says the two Filipinos injured in an accident that led to the death of another Filipino are now recovering. Authorities in China's Guangdong province enact emergency measures following heavy rains that have swelled major waterways and reservoirs. Aerial footage shows villages and farmlands inundated by floods, as well as landslide cutting off several areas. Guangdong is a major exporter and one of China's main commercial and trading centers. It has seen major downpours and strong winds for several days in a weather pattern which has also affected other parts of the country. Forecasters expect heavy rain through Monday in the Guangxi region, as well as the Guangdong, Fujian, and Zhejiang provinces. Let's now get an update on the weather from PAGASA forecaster Ben Estrajera.
Good morning, Bettina, and to all the viewers of ANC. As of now, we have a low pressure area outside the Philippine area of responsibility, and this trough or extension is affecting the southern portion of Mindanao. Expect some cloudy skies with scattered rain showers and thunderstorms today over Basilan, Sulu, Tawi-Tawi, and some nearby areas. Landslides and flash floods are possible, whereas in this morning, some parts of eastern and central portions of Visayas may also get some cloudy skies due to easterlies. The rest of Visayas and Mindanao will have partly cloudy to cloudy skies with some isolated rain showers or thunderstorms, whereas the rest of Luzon will continue to have fair weather conditions, which means mostly clear skies over northern and central Luzon due to a high pressure area somewhere in the northeast over the North Pacific Ocean and Metro Manila, and the rest of the zone will have partly cloudy skies with some isolated rain showers as well. Range of temperature over Metro Manila is from 25 to 35 degrees Celsius, but there will still be areas in which the heat index could reach up to more than 42 degrees Celsius or under the danger level, such as PD Camarines Sur up to 45 degrees Celsius, Aborlan and Puerto Princesa up to 44 degrees, and some areas, highly urbanized areas and low-lying areas may reach 42 to 43 degrees Celsius, which includes Cagayan, Dagupan, some areas of Tarlac, and parts of Visayas. And that's the latest from PAGASA Weather Forecasting Center. This is Benison Estareja reporting.
Thank you very much for that update, Benison.